Okay, so thank you so much for that. The next commentator is not present here or even in the Zoom, but I think he kind of sent a video of his comments, and his name is Eric Solheim, Vice President of Euro-Asia Center, former Under Secretary of the United Nations. So, yes, Captain Andy.
Hello, everyone. I'm really honored to be asked to address the forum on promotion and protection of minority rights. This is truly an important issue. Look, nearly all nations in the world are multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-religious, and all nations have a divergence of political views, and there are minorities, sexual, when it comes to handicaps, and in many other ways. So promotion and protection of minority rights is one of the most central issues of our time. So I'm so pleased that you put this front and center in this conference in Kuala Lumpur and other places. The UN has made a number of resolutions, of course, about everything, the Convention of Human Rights from the early days of the United Nations, but many other conventions and decisions on this issue. That's a very good platform for the discussion. And I'd like to add that the Global South has a particular contribution to these issues. In many areas, the Global South is leading. Look, the first nation in the world who got an indigenous leader was Bolivia in South America, in Evo Morales. India, a couple of years back, elected a president who comes from the scheduled caste and from the indigenous people of the state of Odisha. And Bolivia and India are just two examples of developing nations taking the lead in getting the relationship between minorities and the majority population right in so many nations. Allow me to make three comments to this discussion. First, let's see this as an enormous opportunity, not a problem. It's true, of course, that there can be conflicts related to minorities and conflicts related to the relationship between minorities and majorities in many nations, but overall, this is an enormous opportunity for a richer cultural discourse in the world and for richer human exchanges. If we are different, if we are diverse, well, we can communicate, we can come together, and we can learn from each other. If we're all the same, well, there will be very little learning. Learning comes from the fact that we have different religions, different culture, different languages, different sexual orientation, and in so many other ways are different. Differences are no threat to humanity, and it's an enormous source of inspiration and an opportunity to get a better planet if we work together. Secondly, let's stop blaming each other. Sometimes you see people blaming other nations for their way of handling this issue. The issue of minority rights, promotion and protection of minorities is a global issue. I'm not aware of any nation in the world who has got it perfect. We're all struggling. We're all students. We all want to learn. Let's work together to find the right solutions. And if we want to work together, we need to foster a spirit of dialogue. That's of course that with this conference, but I really want this idea to be promoted in the years to come. Let us not politicize the issue, but see it as an issue where we can learn from each other and find the right solutions together. And finally, let's be practical. And let me give you a couple of examples from the field where I'm most engaged, environment, as to how we can advance from this issue. In Brazil, the issue of how to protect the rainforest is very central. The current Brazilian government has understood very well that a core to solve the issue of the protection of rainforest is to mobilize the indigenous communities. There are Native Americans in all the forests of Brazil. They know the place, they are close to the nature, and they can be the first line protectors of the forest if they are mobilized and if they are armed to do it. The indigenous group cannot fight the army, not fight the state. They are not powerful enough to do that, but they can win if they work with the state and if they are empowered by the state to protect the rainforest. The indigenous group are out in the forest and know everything which is happening. They can act very fast if they are made, given the power to act. Another very similar issue is the enormous opportunities which we now have in solar and wind farms in the world. But look, modern solar farms and wind farms are not small and cute. I just visited the biggest solar farm in the world near Urumqi in Xinjiang in China. That one farm is 4 gigawatt. That's more than the entire energy net, the entire grid of Nigeria, the biggest nation in Africa, just in one farm in China. So of course it's enormous. But that brings to the core the issue that you need to get the consent of the local people. Sometimes the local people are from majority populations, but very often local people in deserts or faraway parts of the world are from indigenous groups or from minorities. You cannot tell them how to act, but you need to work with them to find the right solutions. And of course, some of the profit, some of the value from the green revolution will have to remain with the local communities. So if we see the relationship to minority groups and the protection and promotion of them as an enormous asset in the green revolution of the world, we will succeed. If we try to do the green revolution without acting with the people, we will fail. I wish you a complete success with this most important meeting, and I'm looking forward to getting to know more about the results, because I think it will be a huge contribution to the global discourse on minority rights. Thank you so much.